So Medicare approved indications for PET CT. This is a US list. This is Medicare is for reimbursement of most of the for the patients. And you can see in the US that head and neck, thyroid, breast, lung is a famous, colon, rectum, lymphoma, melanoma. All these cancers are reimbursed. So it is used for diagnosis, staging and restaging. So obviously this is not an experimental tool. This is not something which is out of the blue. It is already in practice for the last 15 years. There's nothing new in it. Next. So National Comprehensive Cancer Workout Practice Guidelines in Oncology. So again, you have indications in all these cancers. Next. So I would like to tell some cases in which PET CT has been useful. So this is a 47-year-old man who incidentally had a lung nodule. And just press it once. So this is the PET image which shows a focal uptake in the nodule. Next. So thoracotomy was done for this patient and it came and the frozen section was done for this nodule and it came as negative. But later on, depending on the FDG PET findings, they went and they found out that this the frozen section showed no cancer, but a wedge resection was done. The wedge resection showed poorly differentiated cancer, so the patient underwent upper lobectomy. So obviously, it has characterized this lesion, it has characterized this nodule. Next. Lesion characterization. So this is an 84-year-old man with a chronic cough. And chest x-ray showed a pulmonary nodule. And CT showed a 13-millimeter nodule in the left lower lobe. Here you can see the nodule. With a rim calcification. So this is the nodule. And then did a PET and shows no significant uptake. PET was negative. Just press it once more. Yeah. This is the fused image of PET as well as CT, which shows that absolutely there is no uptake in the nodule. So no further imaging. Patient is fine. Next. So this is again a case of carcinoma colon. And this is a hemicolectomy has been done for this patient and the patient comes with rising CEA levels. The patient has had a CT, but this is a non-contrast CT. The non-contrast CT was done because creatinine levels were elevated, so contrast could not be given to this patient. And absolutely you can see that you are not able to see anything. But PET showed a solitary hypometabolic nodule in the left lobe of liver. So patient had a laparotomy and pathologically this lesion was confirmed to be a metastatic colonic cancer. Next. So again, this is a case of carcinoma thyroid who has underwent thyroidectomy. And after thyroidectomy, a radioactive iodine treatment has been done. And after 3 months, the patient comes with a whole body iodine scan. The whole body iodine scan is negative, but the TG levels are high. So this is a discrepancy. When your biochemical levels are high and the iodine scan is negative, we did a PET and you see the lymph nodes. Yeah. You can see the nodes which are showing up there. Next. So unknown primary. So you must be getting a lot of these kind of cases in which there is a right neck mass. And this right neck mass is there. You don't know where the primary is. Next. So you see a right cervical lymph node which is highly FDG avid. Next. And here you see the primary is in the left piriform lesion. So the right piriform fossa you have a FDG avid nodule. So you can know where the primary is if you have the secondary, if the patient presents with the secondary lymph node, you can know where the unknown primary is. Next. Staging. Now staging, here is a patient for the lung cancer and here what you can see is a left upper lobe hypermetabolic mass, and here you see that there is a focal uptake in the abdomen. Next, just press it. Yeah, next, next, yeah, next, yeah. This is just in front of, there is a, this is a soft tissue mass in the psoas, and a CT was done, IV contrast was given, and it was an enhancing mass lesion. So this patient is having a distant metastasis. He is stage 4, so he is inoperable. So patient developed additional distant metastasis and died after few months. So obviously, whether it is operable or inoperable, especially it is the modality to know whether it is for M stage. Next. Recurrent disease. Now there is a very, there is a great confusion to the clinicians whether the patient is having recurrent disease after radiation therapy. The patient, especially most of the patients, have radiation therapy and they have a good survival after that. Especially this, the patient underwent a laryngectomy, you have a postoperative scar which you cannot say whether it is a recurrent disease. You have radiation given, radiation induced necrosis around that area, you are really not able to say. Now has dysphagia. Click. Next. So there is a recurrent disease in the postoperative area. Next. So monitoring response to therapy, this is a case of CA lung, 3A, and has received 4 cycles of chemotherapy. Now this is a CT that has been done pre-chemotherapy. Just click it once. So there is a FDG avid nodule. And next. Next. Yeah. So this FDG avid nodule has become metabolically inactive. So in case of adjuvant chemotherapy, or in cases of, in that you would like to assess the lesion, how it responds to chemotherapy before it undergoes for taking up the patient for surgery. So lung cancers are having very poor prognosis. This is a 3A treatable case when underwent adjuvant chemotherapy, and it shows a very good response to chemotherapy. Next. So these are the good things of PET CT. We have to talk the bad things, because good cannot exist without bad. You cannot be a hero if there is no villain. So these are the problems, these are the pitfalls of PET CT. There are false negative findings. We have false positive findings. In false negative findings, the thing is tumor histology. We have bronchoalveolar carcinomas which are not FDG avid. We have mucin secreting adenocarcinomas which are not FDG avid. So when we are seeing these kind of cases, we should know what kind of cancer it is. Lot of times we don't even get a request that what is the clinical history of the patient. So tumor histology is very, very necessary. Lesions smaller than 8 millimeters, there are lesions which are smaller than 8 millimeters which can be falsely negative. Obviously the patient is diabetic, non-fasting patients. Now this diabetes and non-fasting, then what happens is we have to prepare the patient. If the patient is again not prepared well, if the blood sugar is above 300, again you do PET CT, none of the FDG will go into the tumor. Again, a lot of times patient comes, he has to go to Namakkal, so he comes in the morning, he wants to do all the tests and want to return by evening, and he is not, he has had dosas with idli and all those chutney and everything, and he comes non-fasting. We have to do, sometimes what happens if the patient is not completely fasting, what happens is you may get a falsely negative, because the tumor has to be hungry. The tumor has to be hungry to take up the FDG. If the tumor is not hungry, the patient is not hungry, the tumor will not be hungry, and if the tumor is not hungry, you may get a negative result. Falsely positive. Now this is again another problem we have. We have, when the patient is feeling cold, we have the brown fat uptake. We have a lot of normal infections which take place post chemotherapy. We have granulomas and other infection and adenomas. Let us talk about some of the false negative cases. Next. This is the standard CT and a PET CT. This is a 56-year-old man with HCV, which HCV positive, end-stage liver disease, and a presumed hepatoma. So obviously here you can see there is, just click it. Yeah. There is an enhancing mass out here. Next. Yeah, but this is not FDG average. So lot of hepatocellular carcinomas, especially 40% of HCCs do not take up FDG. Next. Similarly, this is the physiological uptake, brown fat uptake that takes place. The patient is feeling very cold. So what is this thing is the brown fat takes up the FDG. So here, this is FDG. This can be well differentiated because CT, next CT, you will find that this doesn't coordinate with any of the anatomical landmarks. So obviously this is fat out here. Next. So this is a brown fat uptake. Next. Infections, yes. When you give the chemotherapy patient as immunosuppressed, again you may get uptake because of infections. This is a case with a solitary lung nodule and biopsy done showed aspergillosis. So this is one of the false positive cases. Next. Granulomatous disease, sarcoidosis and tuberculosis, which is very, very important for our population. So 62-year-old man with hilar and mediastinal adenopathy. So you get hilar lymph nodes. Next. And you will see that these are FDG added. So obviously, patient had a biopsy and it showed sarcoidosis. Now both the tumor and tuberculosis can exist together, because a lot of times the patient has first or two cycles of chemotherapy, patient is immunosuppressed and patient may get tuberculosis, and we have found a lot of cases in which tuberculosis and lung cancers existing together in the same patient. Next. Clinical impact of PET CT is you can make an accurate diagnosis, avoidance of unnecessary tests which may be potentially harmful, better treatment or management. Obviously we should recognize the pitfalls and make use of the advantages of PET CT. The National Oncological PET Registry, it has shown that in all these cancers that approximately 36% of the patients have changed the treatment based on the findings of PET CT. So obviously it has had a great impact in the treatment change in the treatment. Either you have changed the chemotherapy or the patient has become inoperable, or at some areas you have not done a surgery. So approximately 36% have benefited. There has been a treatment change using PET CT. Next. So I would like to just deal something with dementias. Now in dementia and Alzheimer's dementia, we have hypermetabolism in medial and temporal lobes. So you can see that there is hypermetabolism. And this is again a PET CT which has been done. These are the maps and this shows hypermetabolism. Next. So again in dementia, we have seen that there is a hypermetabolism. And this is very classical for Alzheimer's dementia. Next. Perfusion metabolism mismatch, this is seen to differentiate viable myocardium, those patients who would like to go in for a cardiac transplantation versus bypass surgery. So you can see the inferior wall, this is a systemized SPECT, and you can see the FDG which is filling up. Similarly, you see the infralateral wall and you see showing a defect which is filling up. Next. So why PET CT? Obviously, it would really help in the management of the patients. Thank you.